Thanks, Jane. You're watching Southeast Today. Our top story tonight. Migrants in France tell us they're still prepared to risk their lives to reach the UK 2 years after the biggest Channel tragedy.
How will you get to England?
I don't know. Boat, swimming. When I have no money, I have no choice.
Tonight, beach vigils to remember the Channel migrants who drowned at sea. We're in Folkestone with the latest. In other news... From top of the league to top of the table, Brighton legend Bobby Zamora returns to champion the power of community sport.
Isn't Arabia the land of mystery and romance?
No, that's...
Are the bad times all behind them? Panto Productions prepare for another bumper year after COVID cancelled so many Christmas shows. And ready to go again, 90s rock group Republica is back with new music. We chat to lead singer Saffron Spreckling. Hello, welcome to the programme. I'm Ellie Crissell. 2 years on from the deaths of at least 27 people who drowned when their boat sank in the Channel, migrants have told us they are still prepared to risk their lives to make that journey. Tonight, vigils are taking place to mark the anniversary, with charities demanding safe routes for all refugees wanting to come to the UK. In a moment, we'll be live in Folkestone, but first this from our investigations reporter Ben Moore, who's visited camps in northern France to speak to those trying to come here.
Why have you come here?
Just go UK, go England.
I want to go to UK.
I have been here for a month to cross the ocean in order to get to the UK.
The sign at the entrance to this migrant camp on the outskirts of Calais says, be careful when crossing.
How do you get to England?
A boat.
Are you scared though? It's dangerous.
No dangers, go England.
How old are you?
12 years.
We're waiting for weather. Some people say, inshallah, another time will be good.
Well, how will you get to England?
I don't know. Boat, swimming.
The boats are dangerous.
When I have no money, I have no choice.
In a month, I tried 5 times. The boat was for approximately 55 people, and we were in the boat 86 people.
One aid agency told us 1,500 migrants are staying in this area, nearly double what it was in September. The reason? There's been a 30% reduction in small boat crossings compared to the same time last year.
Over the last few weeks, we've given out a total of over 1,000 waterproof pieces of clothing. So that's waterproof coats, it's waterproof bottoms, ponchos.
Aid workers say the weather, not UK or French government policy, is stopping the crossings. But the constant rain and wind is also making their work harder.
The health conditions and the living conditions are dire, and they're the worst that I've ever seen here in Calais. Because it's constantly raining, there's no chance to get dry. So people are outside in these elements at all times. We're seeing mud. People are having to sleep in their shoes, so people are getting issues like trench foot.
Further down the coast, about 35 kilometres south of Calais, is the town of Boulogne. Desperation has led to a change in tactics from migrants and smugglers. Just a few months ago, this beach was the scene of an audacious crossing attempt.
Do you want to repeat it? It says migrants took the sea just in front of tourists.
We saw a crazy scene with a boat and some migrants. They were waiting, but at the same time, we have a lot of tourists. And just near them, we have migrants who are trying to go to England. We never saw this here.
Leaving from here increases the journey to UK shores nearly threefold. And going further south is not the smugglers' only tactic.
The new strategy of smugglers, it's called taxi boats. They are pulling one boat on the water near from here, and after they are going from beach to beach. And why is it so hard for policemen? Because refugees are on the water.
As night falls, we go to see if there are any launch attempts at a beach popular with migrants.
So it's just gone midnight and we're walking along the beach at a place called Gravelines near Dunkirk. A lot of migrants do try and make the trip from here. But it's absolutely freezing and very windy. We think the wind speeds are about 28 knots. It's really inconceivable that anyone would try and make the crossing in these conditions.
But there are signs. This is indeed a popular spot. Hidden amongst the dunes, once valued items have been discarded as the boats are crammed and space is at a premium.
There's a boat down there. There's a boat. So we were just about to leave the beach, it's 20 to 1 in the morning, and we came up a side channel in the dunes, and this is what we found. It's an inflatable boat, about 20 foot, and it's in perfect condition. It's not been damaged. This looks like it's ready to go. You do kind of get the feeling you're being watched.
These dunes could well be the place migrants set out from when there's a break in the weather.
Why not stay here in France? France is safe. Stay in France.
So I know about the language of British as well, so that's why I decided to go to the UK.
France, yes, yeah, safe country, but, you know, I want to live in the UK. I want a good life. I want a better life.
Conditions are appalling here. As well as the weather, this can be a dangerous place.
Every day, every night, gone, fighting, everything. I just want to leave. I don't want to die here.
Why not stay here in France?
Here, life here, it's dangerous.
It's dangerous in the boat as well.
No.
Yet still they say they'll keep trying to get to UK shores, even as the smugglers change their strategy like shifting sand dunes, and despite the warning signs. Ben Moore, BBC Southeast Today, Calais.
Well, tonight, people are attending vigils to mark 2 years since at least 27 people died off the coast of France as they tried to cross the Channel. The government has announced an independent inquiry into what happened. It comes as an open letter calling for safe routes for all refugees wishing to come to the UK has been signed by charities and campaigners.
We've got to stop people feeling like they've got no other option than to put themselves into hands of people smugglers to get across the Channel. We have to give them better options. We have to give them safe and legal routes. And that would destroy the people smugglers' business overnight.
Well, Piers Hopkirk is at the Folkestone vigil for us live this evening. Piers, what's happening there behind you?
Well, Ellie, it's a pretty poignant and sombre scene. Around 50 people have gathered here tonight. Many have brought candles, they brought flowers, and they have brought photographs of the victims, all to mark this, the second anniversary of one of the worst losses of life in the English Channel. And of course, this week we've had a reminder of the perilousness of that journey when two people died off the coast of France, when the boat they were on with 60 people on board capsized. Now, just before the vigil tonight, I spoke to Sangar. He is a 34-year-old asylum seeker from Iraq. He had seven friends on that boat 2 years ago. He said this is a tragedy that must never be forgotten.
I lost several wonderful friends in the disaster, including my childhood friend who passed away in the tragedy. He was my loved ones, and I lost several other friends, which totally I lost seven wonderful friends in that tragedy. This is totally painful. I've now utterly become empathetic about the tragedy, can never be forgotten all my life.
And Piers, this isn't the only vigil being held tonight.
No, that's right, Ellie. There are vigils in Paris, in Dunkirk, and just down the coast in Hastings. And one thread that joins them together, really, is campaigners calling for those safe, legal routes for people travelling from Europe trying to get to the UK. Now, the government says that stopping the small boats remains one of its key priorities. Tonight, a spokesperson told us this. They said, "We will do whatever it takes to end these perilous and fatal journeys, encouraging people to seek safe and legal passage."
Yes, thank you. Well, we can now speak to Folkestone and Hythe's Conservative MP Damian Collins. Mr. Collins, thank you for joining us. As we've just seen there in Ben's report, migrants don't seem to have been remotely deterred from making this dangerous crossing. Your party's pledge to stop these small boats isn't working.
We've seen a significant decrease this year in people arriving on small boats, but I think no one wants to see these crossings continue. There has been tragic loss of life. In some ways, it's miraculous more people haven't died. And that's why it's so important these small boat crossings are stopped, because they are so dangerous. No one needs to get into one of those dinghies. People can claim asylum in France. People have probably travelled across a number of other European countries before getting to the French coast. And I think the fact that people are now prepared to risk longer journeys, with a two or three times longer at sea travelling from places like the Touquet to get to the UK, I think shows that the work that we're doing with the French authorities to make it harder to complete these crossings, make detection more likely, is having an impact. But the message we want to send across is, don't try and enter the country in that way. There are safe and legal routes you can use. There are safe options to claim asylum in France as well. And don't risk your life in the Channel.
But those safe and legal routes which you speak about, clearly it isn't easy enough for people who need to claim asylum, who want to claim asylum, to go through those routes. It seems inconceivable that anybody would choose to make this dangerous journey unless they were absolutely desperate.
Well, there are safe and legal routes. We work every year with the United Nations Refugee Network. There are camps and locations that people can go to, much closer probably to the country where they're trying to escape from. So those routes are there, and every year we accept people through those schemes that have used those safe and legal routes to get to the UK. What we've got to stop, though, is the idea that people traffickers can have a shortcut where people can try and jump the queue and cross the channel to claim asylum in the UK through an illegal crossing on small boats. That's what we're trying to stop. And you know, we're working closely with the French authorities to do that. We've seen a very big fall this year in people crossing from Albania. And the reason for that is that we have a returns agreement with the Albanian government. People know it's futile to try and enter the UK in that way if they're from Albania, and therefore they've stopped doing it. And that's the message we've got to get across, which is crossing the channel in a dinghy, entering the country illegally, is not a shortcut to getting the right to stay in this country, and you will not have the right to reside in this country if you enter the UK in that way. And it's by getting that message across we can get people to stop making these journeys, and that's what we all want to see, is to stop these crossings which are risking lives.
Briefly, if you can, what's your view on the Rwanda policy? Do you still back it?
I still think the idea of processing outside of the UK is one we should continue to look at. Other European governments are doing something similar. I think Italy has said it wants to have a processing agreement with Albania. So clearly the principle of processing claims outside of the country where someone has arrived is what other countries accept. And whether that is in Rwanda or elsewhere, I think we should do the same.
Damian Collins, thank you for joining us. In other news, a drink driver has been jailed for 10 and a half years over a hit-and-run crash which killed a woman in Kent. 25-year-old Bradley Kane, who admitted causing death by dangerous driving, was also speeding and under the influence of drugs at the time of the incident in Charing Heath last September. His Ford Fiesta hit a 28-year-old woman and her young child crossing the road. Parts of a 15th century castle in East Sussex have been forced to close after it was deemed unsafe. A number of serious structural issues have been found at the Grade 1 listed Hurstmonceux Castle. Operations there have been suspended. Now, when the COVID pandemic forced the cancellation of Christmas pantomimes, many wondered if theatre's best days were behind them. But oh no, they weren't. Show producers are now forecasting a bumper year for festive audiences. Evolution Productions, which produces pantos across the southeast, says ticket revenue has risen 17% compared with this time last year. This year, 82,000 tickets have been snapped up at the Marlow in Canterbury, one of Kent's largest venues, surpassing 2019 numbers, meaning that 94% of all seats across that six-week run of Aladdin have now gone. Charlie Rose reports.
We need everyone to do this, Al. Even this guy in the third row, desperately trying to avoid eye contact.
It's the final dress rehearsal before tonight's opening performance of Aladdin at Canterbury's Marlowe Theatre. One of the stars of the show is professional dancer and Strictly winner Kevin Clifton, who's making his pantomime debut.
On the one hand, it's really exciting. Also, I'm feeling this sort of weight of expectation because everyone keeps telling me, like, oh, if you go Canterbury, that's basically the best one in the country.
Yeah.
But I'm in good hands because I'm with this guy and he's very experienced at pantomime. He knows what he's doing.
Apparently.
Yeah.
Apparently I know what I'm doing. No idea, Charlie.
Well, he must be doing something, right? Because Ben Roddy is about to make his 1,000th appearance at the Marlowe.
Feels incredible, really, because I'm only 27.
Everyone knows about him. And like, I was in a cafe having breakfast yesterday, and the first thing they said was like, oh, you're doing the panto, aren't you? I said, yeah, I'm doing the panto. With Ben Roddy. I said, yeah, like everyone's talking about this guy all the time.
And here they're talking about ticket sales. The company behind Aladdin is running 10 pantomimes across the country, including Sleeping Beauty in Crawley. They say they're seeing a 17% rise in box office revenue from ticket sales compared to last year. Why? People are seeking the feel-good factor, apparently.
I mean, if you look in the world today, there are some things which aren't very nice. You know, you watch the news, no offence. There's a lot of bad news out there. You come here and for 2 hours, you just have a great time.
And tonight, they can't wait to get going.
It might be Kevin's first panto, but the man is a legend. He's a pro and he can move. Ladies, he can move.
Thanks, mate.
You're very welcome.
You started walking across Antarctica with no shoes on? Why'd you turn back?
I've got cold feet!
And with jokes like that, who can resist a bit of festive pantomime fun? Charlie Rose, BBC South East Today, Canterbury.
Now it's almost 10 to 7, a reminder of our top story tonight. 2 years on from the deaths of at least 27 people who drowned when their small boat sank in the Channel, migrants tell us they are still prepared to risk their lives to get to the UK. Tonight, vigils take place as charities demand safe routes for all refugees. Also in tonight's programme, from top of the league to top of the table, Brighton legend Bobby Zamora returns to champion the power of community sport.
And this weekend is going to be very cold, some frosty mornings, but sunshine on Saturday, although Sunday is looking a little cloudier. I've got the details later in the programme.
Now, with her signature red bob and fierce energy, Saffron Sprackling is the Sussex singer who burst onto the Britpop stage with Republica in the 1990s. 30 years on, she is still headlining gigs and performing new material. She'll join us live in a moment, but first let's take a look at the band in action. Well, Saffron joins me now, looking and sounding brilliant.
Love
the video.
Thank you so much.
Look at that.
I know.
It's a bit Britney Spears, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. I love Britney. Yeah, Team Britney. Yes, there was a lot of CGI and green screen involved. And my very great friends, the filmmakers, Ben and Annalise Simon, ran Media Brighton, and they're also musicians, and they worked so hard to help us, well, to, to help me, really. I had a vision already for the video, which is a bit Blade Runner-esque,
very.
Sort of Fifth Element, Star Wars.
Love it, yes. Love it. And this is the first new music that you've released in, what, 10 years?
In a decade, yes,
wow.
Yes.
Wow. It's so exciting. It's a big moment.
It
like,
really
were you nervous
is.
About... going back in with something new again?
Well, we already, before the pandemic, we already had the album, there. The album's called Damaged God, all the irony now. Mm. and so after, obviously, the lockdown restrictions were lifted, we started headlining festivals in the UK and Europe and abroad.
Yeah, because and then, that yeah. 90s sound, like I feel like all the youngsters, all the teens are really into their 90s, aren't they?
Well, it's amazing.
It all comes back round.
It's amazing,
and we've got your
yeah.
hits are around again in popular culture, films and adverts.
Yeah, I mean, we've been so lucky, you know, in the head of Marvel Films chose Ready to Go as the official music for the trailer of Captain Marvel, you know, unbelievable.
And
we've been in Yellow Jacket, Ted Lasso, Cool Summer, so, Two or Dark, you know, all the very contemporary, you know, so it's opened us up to a whole new young generation.
Well, I was going to say, you must have a whole new swathe of fans,
yeah,
as a result.
And always a massive sports anthem, so we're just, you know,
it's that
blessed.
Kind of driving,
yeah.
pumping, rocky thing.
Yeah.
It goes so well, doesn't it, with so much
Yeah,
so much
and to have Ready to Go up there with AC/DC and Queen, you know, playing in football stadiums and rugby and baseball, basketball, you know, it's just phenomenal. We're blessed. Yeah.
So you're still loving your touring, loving those
yeah.
live audiences post pandemic.
Oh, it's
nice to be back out.
It's fantastic. Yeah, yeah, super.
Well, keep going from strength to strength. It's so nice to see
Thank
you. Good
you
luck
so
with the
much.
New hit and the new album.
Yeah,
and the
New
tour.
York's out now, so we'll be doing a tour in the new year.
And
thank you so much for
Pleasure.
Having me.
Pleasure. Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. Best of luck. Now, with more than 80 goals in just 3 seasons, Bobby Zamora remains a hero to Brighton fans, propelling the Seagulls to back-to-back promotions. He would also play for England and grace the Premier League. Today, he was back on the Sussex coast, topping tables of a different kind to celebrate the power of community sport, as James Dunn explains.
Rallying for this club and community, which welcomes everyone from Paralympians to pensioners. Founder Tim Holtom is a hero to hundreds of members here. Today he was handed a National Lottery Award from one Brighton legend to another.
Brilliant, brilliant day. This is an award for the whole club, you know. This is a National Lottery Sport Award, but it's very much about a collective effort. Everyone who contributes to this, making this place work, and it's a special place.
Will Bailey is training for the Paris Paralympics and helping the next generation of players here in Brighton, like Bly Toomey, just 13 years old and set to qualify for next year's Games. He's been working with Tim since winning gold in Tokyo.
I've obviously got a passion for para table tennis, disabled players playing table tennis. He's got a passion for welcoming everyone from every different background, and he's very passionate about that. And so we kind of like have the same ethos. We want to get people in, we want to get people to love table tennis because we love it so much.
Paralympic bronze medalist Jack is the first wheelchair player to play in the able-bodied league for this club.
It's absolutely incredible. This place is not just the hub of elite talent, as you see Will and Bly and people like that. It's a really hub of the community. It gives a lot of people to a lot of lives, and I think it's amazing what they do around here. It's truly unique. I've been lucky enough to play all around the world, and this setup is one of the best I've ever been in.
Straight into your lens.
Presenting the award was Bobby Zamora, an Albion legend who won 2 promotions with the Seagulls and went on to play for England. But places like this were a vital part of his journey to playing at the top level.
Me as a kid, I used to come out of school, either play football in the park or go to the youth centre. So the youth centre was huge, you know, whether it was basketball, table tennis. Without this being here, without Tim doing what he's done, those guys wouldn't have the opportunity and they wouldn't be, you know, out there representing their country and achieving such amazing things.
Some members will be back in the spotlights at the Paris Paralympics next year, but the table tennis on TV is just a tiny glimpse of all they do here to serve their community being celebrated today. James Dunn, BBC South East Today, Brighton.
In football, Brighton will be hoping to end their winless league run when they travel to Nottingham Forest in the Premier League tomorrow. And in League Two, Gillingham are at Tranmere and Crawley host Harrogate. On Sunday, Brighton are at Liverpool in the Women's Super League. Time now for a look at the weather. Nina Ridge is with us, and we've got some flood warnings in Medway.
Yes, across the Medway, that northerly wind, high tide this evening, and we'll just get some high waters there, but short-lived, because of course it's dry. It's been a dry day. Cloudy skies this morning as that weather front moved its way through in Hove, but by this afternoon we're into the colder air and we had the sunshine. It will stay pretty chilly this weekend. It is going to be cold with those temperatures below average through the day, and also overnight we'll see some frosty nights, but the high pressure will stay with us, so it is going to be a dry weekend. If we take a look at what's happening as the overall picture through the weekend, you can see that northerly wind coming down from the North Sea, and on Saturday we'll have clear skies. Now, whilst the high just moves across us through the weekend, the winds fall lighter, but there is an approaching weather front through the day on Sunday, and that just starts to throw ahead some cloud through the second half of the weekend. So it is looking a little more overcast on Sunday with the cloudy skies as that weather front just heads towards us. But overnight tonight, very little cloud. So with those clear skies, those temperatures are going to fall away. Many of us will see a frost. We're looking at lows of -2 degrees. Couple of exceptions, particularly around the coast. And again, as we look across East Kent, with that wind coming down from the north, it's a little stronger and it just helps to keep those temperatures just above freezing. But it is going to be chilly during the morning. We've got some sunshine, some blue skies to take us through the day. The winds will be a little lighter than they have been today, but temperatures still below average at around 6 or 7 degrees. Saturday evening, again, it's dry with some clear spells. Perhaps a little bit of clouds coming and going overnight, but once again, we will see temperatures falling below freezing quite widely. So we're looking at lows on Sunday morning of -2 degrees. For Sunday morning, we've got some early brightness, a little bit of sunshine first thing, but it shouldn't last too long because as the day goes on, we saw that weather front, it starts to bring with it some cloud pushing its way further east. And as that cloud thickens in towards the afternoon, more western areas may just start to pick up a little bit of patchy light rain and drizzle, and those temperatures still at around 6 to 7 degrees. That low pressure system spirals across us on Monday. We stay in the cold air, but the cloud and rain will move to the south of us. And by Tuesday, whilst it's still chilly, we're back to the dry and the bright conditions. Ellie.
Hats and scarves and gloves at the ready. Thank you very much, Nina. That is it from me and from Nina and from the rest of the team. Linda Hardy will be back with your late news at 10:30. Bye-bye.